everyone, Beck Photography here, back with another video. Thank you very much for watching. Today we're going to be looking at the Sigma 35mm f1.4 and how you can take 35mm portraits with a 35mm 1.4, 35mm 1.8 or similar lens like that. But before we get into the video, make sure to check out in the description a guide that I've just made on how to take portraits at nighttime. I spent a lot of time really working hard on this guide and I think it's going to be really informative to anyone who's looking at taking portraits at nighttime. So thank you for checking that out. So now let's get into the video and talk about taking portraits with a 35mm lens. So on this photo shoot, I used a Sony a7R II camera body with a Sigma 35mm f1.4, but this tutorial is going to be relevant for anyone using any type of camera body and 35mm lens or something similar to a 35mm, so let's say a 28 or a 42mm or something similar like that. I'm also going to leave in the description all the equipment that I used in this photo shoot, as well as a link to the RAW files so that you can edit some of the photos that I'm showing you in this video and also edit along when we're doing the Photoshop section of this tutorial at the end of the video. So here we are with Rhiannon next to a fountain and it is about an hour and a half before sunset. And the reason we chose to shoot an hour and a half before sunset is because that is when the sun is nice and low in the sky. And that means for natural light portraits, we're going to get really nice smooth skin tones on our model's face and just the whole illumination of the subject is going to be nice and even. So you can see in the background, it is way brighter than it is in the foreground. You can see in the background that that is where the sun is. And basically the reason we're using backlit light here is because we can get some nice illumination on Rhiannon's hair, but we're not going to be causing any harsh lighting or shadows on her face. So when you're shooting with a 35mm, the 35mm is quite a wide angle lens, so you have to consider the distortion and warpage that this lens is going to produce, particularly if you're shooting really close to your subject and with your subject having part of their body kind of going out of the frame or near to out of the frame into the corners of the image, because the further out a part of the subject is in the frame, the more distortion you're going to see. So in the center, you're not going to get that much distortion, but as you go closer to your subject and as your subject gets further out in the frame of your photo, the more distorted they're going to be. So you can see in this photo here, the Rhiannon's legs, particularly her left leg, are looking super long. And the reason for her left leg being so long in this image is because her leg is approaching the corner of the image. So not only is it approaching the side, which is where distortion is going to happen, it's approaching the corner of the entire image, which is where the most distortion is seen. So if you look closely, you can actually see that her shoe on our right, is much bigger than the shoe on the left. And that's just because it's been stretched by the corner of the image because of the distortion from the wide-angle lens. So shooting at a wide-angle lens can be really flattering to our model because it can make them look more slender and more long and thin. But what it can also do is make someone's features look more long and thin, and that can be bad if you're shooting really close up just doing something like a headshot. But that is another stylistic choice that you have when doing portraits with a 35mm. So when you're doing portraits with a 35mm, in my opinion, you need to get nice and close to your subject because the 35mm is really good at getting a connection with your subject when you're taking these photos because you feel like you're there. Your 35mm, particularly on an APS-C camera, so something like an 80D, a 90D, something like that, it's going to fill out to more of a 50mm focal length, so less of a wide angle lens, but it's still going to give you a really nice idea of the surroundings and it's not going to crop in super close just on your subject. So it's a really great lens to get nice and close to your subject so you feel like you're in the surroundings, you can get a nice context of where you are, and also you feel like you're there and close and a part of the action. If you're shooting on a 35mm at f1.8 or even 1.4, you're going to get really nice blurry out of focus backgrounds, but it's not going to be as blurry as shooting with something like a 50, and definitely not something it's definitely not going to be as blurry as shooting with something like an 85mm lens. And even if you're shooting on something like a 70 to 200 at an aperture of f2.8, that's going to be much more blurry than shooting on a 35mm at f1.4. And that's just due to the nature of wide angle lenses being less blurry in the background because you have less compression in your image with wide angle lenses. So you can still get some really nice separation with a 35mm, but you're not going to expect to see these super blurry, massive blobs of bokeh in the background unless you're shooting really, really close up with your 35mm lens. Because you're shooting on a wide angle lens with a 35mm, you have a little bit more flexibility with the shutter speed and you can shoot at lower shutter speeds because you're not going to see the camera shake that you would in a telephoto lens, like let's say a 200mm. So as a general rule, they say that you should never shoot at less than double your focal length. So For example, if you're shooting on a 35mm, you probably wouldn't want to shoot at lower than about 1/70th of a second before you start introducing camera shake. And that is just talking about handheld photography. If you're shooting on a tripod, you can get a little bit lower as long as your model stays super still. I like to shoot no slower than about 1/160th of a second, just because I have quite shaky hands, and when I'm shooting in natural light on a bright day during the day, I don't really see any need to shoot slower than that, because I can shoot at an ISO of 100, which is the base ISO of my camera, which means I'll get the most high fidelity signal to my sensor for the image generation. I don't need to bring my shutter speed any lower to potentially introduce camera shake into my photos. So before we go into Photoshop and do some editing on a couple of these photos, let's have a recap of what we've talked about. So make sure that when you're shooting with a 35mm to get nice and close to your subject so you feel like you're in the photo. Make sure that your subject doesn't have their limbs too close to the edges unless you're wanting them to look way more stretched out than they would normally. You can shoot at quite slow shutter speeds with a 35mm because it's a wide angle lens. And finally, at low apertures, you are going to see some nicer background separation from your subject and the background, but you won't see as much compression as you would in a 50mm or an 85mm or a longer lens in general. So just before we jump into Photoshop, make sure you download the raw files in the description so you can follow along with the editing process. And also leave a like and subscribe if you're enjoying this video so far. It really helps me in the algorithm because it's getting very competitive with YouTube and it's quite difficult to stand out these days in YouTube. So now let's jump into Photoshop and have a look at the editing on a photo that I did in this photo shoot. Okay, so the first thing I notice about this image is that it's very low contrast. And the reason for that is because we're shooting directly into the sun, and the sun is actually in this area right here. So the first thing we're gonna do is add some clarity to the entire image, just to make the mid-tone contrast really pop, and then we're gonna add some extra contrast as well, just into the image right there like that. So now we've got some blown out highlights, particularly up here and also in the face as well. So we're just gonna drop those highlights a little bit like this. And then we'll play around with the lighting and the whites and maybe add some more shadows in there as well. And we're just gonna play with the exposure a little bit there as well, and maybe change the color balance just to be a little bit more yellow. Now I'm gonna mess around with the vibrance just to make all the colors look nice and bright. And then I'm gonna go into the color channels and just add a little bit more blue into the image as well. Okay, so the next thing I like to do is, I've just got a new keyboard and it's quite loud, so I'm sorry about that. So the next thing we're gonna do is just go to the eyes, and I'm gonna add a little bit of exposure and also some contrast as well, just to make them pop from the scene, because when you're looking at a portrait, the eyes are the first things that you really look at. Then I'm going to add a little bit of shadowing just to the nostrils as well, just to make the nose stand out from the scene as well. Might be a little bit too much. Perfect. So now you can really see that the eyes are the focal point of this image. The next thing we're gonna do is just add a little bit of clarity to the hair, just to make that stand out, and also make the highlights and the shadows and the different colors in the hair stand out a little bit more. So I'm gonna just drop the exposure and the blacks just so I can see exactly where I'm selecting, because I just don't wanna select anywhere other than the hair at the moment. Once I've got a selection of all the hair, then I can add some clarity to the hair and make that look a little bit more punchy, and just make the highlights and shadows look a little bit stronger in the hair. Because when you're shooting into the sun, the main problem that you're gonna have is just adding contrast back into the image, just so it really stands out and pops and everything looks nice and colorful. Okay, so I'm just gonna remove those blacks and exposure changes. And then now you can see this was beforehand, and then as we add a little bit more, it just looks a little bit nicer, a little bit more bold. And I'm also going to add a little bit of yellow as well, just a tiny bit of yellow, just to make it look like the sun is shining a little bit more on that. Okay, that looks really good. The next thing I'm going to do is just change the top here to be a little bit less blue, because when I added more blue here, it actually made this top a little bit more blue as well. So I'm just going to drop the exposure and the blacks and just make a little bit of a mask here. It doesn't have to be super, super accurate, because we're using a feathered brush here, so it just kind of like fades away on the corners. Okay, that's about right, I should think. Now I'm going to drop the blacks exposure, change that color balance back to normal, just drop the saturation very slightly, just to make it look a little bit less blue. Okay, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to make a selection of this arm here, just of the skin, and then I'm going to do a one pass with clarity just to make the skin look a little bit more smooth. And this is just like a really quick way of making skin smooth. And if you were going to do something like a production quality image where someone was paying like a lot of money for it, like maybe you're doing a movie poster or something like that, or you were doing some high-end portraits, you probably wouldn't want to use this technique because it is kind of a rough technique. But in the interest of time, it's a very quick way of smoothing skin. So I'm just going to make a selection of all the areas that I'd like to smooth. I do get roasted in the comments for doing this technique, so feel free to roast me in the comments if you don't like this technique. I think it's really good, a quick way just to smooth the skin, but yeah, it's definitely a bit of a rough way of doing it. Okay, so just removing those blacks and exposure changes again, and then just dropping the clarity a little bit just to make them nice and smooth. And we'll do the same thing on the face here as well. But probably not quite as dramatically, because Brandon's skin was actually really, really good, so there really isn't that much for me to do here. And because when you're shooting at an aperture of f1.4, the eyes will be sharp, but the skin, especially to the sides of the face, is going to start blurring out and looking nice and creamy, so any imperfections that there were in the skin kind of melt away anyway. So that should be enough. Just going to remove those changes again, and then this is before, and then just reducing it a little bit to make it nice and smooth. So now let's open this image up, and we're honestly pretty much done. One final thing that I will do is just go to filter and then liquify and just make the hair look a little bit fuller. Just very subtle changes here. You don't want to warp the entire background, and if you do warp the background, just try to fix it up a little bit as well. Just make really tiny changes here. You're just trying to make the hair look a little bit more thick. Without distorting the facial features and that kind of thing. So just doing that a little bit really makes a big difference to the hair. So one final thing I'm going to do is just liquefy this little part of the arm here, because I think this little bump is just a little bit distracting, and it's because of the way her arm is positioned. There's just a little bump here, and I think if I just slightly push that in, that will look a little bit more natural. Okay, so before and after. So that is everything for this photo. I really hope you enjoyed watching and found it informative, and I hope that you learned something about the Sigma 35mm lens. If you're thinking about buying this lens, there's going to be a link in the description to it as well, along with all the other equipment that I used on this photo shoot. If you got this far and you haven't subscribed, make sure to hit that subscribe button and hit the bell as well so you get notified when my next video comes out as well. So once again, thank you very much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.